All right, good morning, everybody. We're going to go ahead and get started. So if you want to find your seat, and after you've done so, would you please rise to your feet as we sing, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
All right. Aloha and good morning, everyone. Welcome to Mililani Community Church. Perfect. A couple of announcements just to get us rolling. In Mililani Community Church, there's a lot of traditions that we actually have in our church, and some of them being mission trips, some of them being the Turkey Bowl. If you ever played in that, it's football and a lot of people get hurt. And that really is a tradition. People, like, every year we play, like, a broken nose or something. But I encourage you, please come out. But one of the biggest things that I do want to promote is that our tradition that we do is Advent Log. This has been something that, as long as I've been coming to church here, it's a great way to bring the family together and kind of recenter what Christmas is. Having Christ in it. So I just want to let you guys know that there is sign up in the back. Please pre-order, just because they need to kind of order these things out, and it just makes it a little bit easier to do. But this is definitely what it could look like. If you know what it looks like, you know what it looks like, but this is definitely what it could look like, and it is a really wonderful tradition that we have here. Thank you, Nate. And then just a couple other announcements. men's prayer breakfast. Please definitely sign up. Uncle John just wants me to kind of remind everyone that this is just more for a head count, just so we know that we get, you know, enough cracker and cheese for everyone. But definitely come for prayer for it. And then next week, Sunday, October 24th, we will be celebrating Mililani Community Church 41st year anniversary. So we will be celebrating and just uplifting our elders and Pastor Jason. So please definitely be around, stick around, and there'll be chichidango at the end. And then the last announcement, and this is actually another tradition that I kind of forgot we end up doing, but we do Operation Christmas Child. This is definitely something that MCC really, really supports. And I'm going to have Andrea come, and she's going to talk a little bit more about this.
Hello. So hopefully all of you have heard about Operation Christmas Child because it is a tradition with the church. And we are here. We're the new project leaders. My kiddos are helping me this year because it is one of our family's favorite things to do around Christmas. It helps us through the Halloween season. Thinking about this instead. So if you're familiar, great. Still grab a brochure back there and grab your box. But if you're not familiar, I'm just going to really quickly go through and tell you about it. This week, or this year, the National Collection Week is November 15th through the 22nd, but we'll be collecting boxes all the way up until November 21st. That'll be the last Sunday that you can bring them. Then I can bring them and drop them off the next day. So first, what you need to do is you grab one of these labels, and you can either choose a boy or a girl, and they have age designations for 2 to 4 year olds, 5 to 9 year olds, or 10 to 14 year olds. Choose that. You can use, I've got some boxes in the back if you want to do a cardboard box. They say usually like a medium sized shoe box, or you can do a plastic bin if you like, just kind of make it a medium size. And it tells you what to pack. So it's kind of a wow item, like a soccer ball or a doll or something. And then hygiene items or, you know, some school supplies. Put that in there, and they also ask for you to donate $9 per box. That helps with the shipping and distribution, and also they do the greatest journey. It's discipleship, and just pretty much the whole point of this is to share Jesus Christ with children around the world. And then you bring it, and you can also do them online. This year they are having it where you can like pack it all online if you don't want to go out and buy the stuff. But it is a lot of fun, especially with families, just to go and gather all the stuff, put it in the box, put your $9 in. But then most important it is to pray over your box, because a child will receive it. A lot of them, it's their first present ever. And so what a way to share Christ with a child around Christmas. So if you have any questions, we'll be in the back after the service. But just grab a brochure. It tells you items not to pack also, but just grab this and grab me if you've got any questions. We're excited. And I hope that you can join with me and say, I'll pack a shoebox.
Awesome. And as we continue, I'm pretty sure she'll come up and just give a little bit more details. I really appreciated it when they... I'm a typical guy. I don't read the manual. So I really like it when they come up and tell us what can we pack, what can't we pack. So I look forward to that. Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and open us up in scripture. Please join me in reading 2 Corinthians. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 17, 21. This is in the New Testament. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 to 21. I'll wait for you guys to kind of get there. And then if you need a little hint, it's after 1 Corinthians. All right. Awesome. So here we are. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 17, 21. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us in the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you, on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. I'm just going to open us up in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for just giving us a wonderful Sunday. Lord, I just pray for our upcoming weeks that we continue to do what we need to do, but live a life that is Christ-centered, live a purposeful life. I pray over this this service that you just open our hearts, our minds, and our ears as Pastor Jason just gives the word. And Lord, we just give you all the glory. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Keith. Can I have everyone stand as we continue our worship service together and singing?
My life, my strength.
left your home. You left your home to seek out the lost. You knew the great and terrible cost. But Jesus, your face was sad. I worked my fingers down to the bone, but nothing I think can ever atone. But Jesus, you paid. You died that I might reap what you have sown. And you rose that I might be a new creation. I am born again by grace and grace alone. I was in darkness all of my life. I never knew the day from the night. The Spirit you made. Father, by grace we are saved through Jesus Christ alone. Nothing of ourselves deserves saving, but you chose us to be part of your kingdom, part of your family, and we thank you. May we now learn from Pastor Jason as he comes up to preach your word on keeping an evangelistic outlook in this world. We ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Thanks, Jess. Oh, good morning. Good to see all of you and those outside. Wanted to share some good news with you last week, but didn't get word for me to get permission to share it until after the service started, so want to do it now. We have some good news. Those of you who know Josh and Emma, Shiroma, they gave birth to Layla Shiroma last week, Saturday, at 9:43 in the morning, 6 pounds, 10 ounces, and 20 inches long. So be in prayer for this new addition to their family, and pray for them as they care for this newborn, precious newborn. So lift them up, Josh and Emma and Layla. All right. Let's pray, and then let's open God's Word to John chapter 20. Father, thank you so much for allowing us the privilege to worship you, Lord. And we just ask for your blessing now as we open your Word. Give us eyes to see, ears to hear. Meet us where we are this morning as we walk through these doors. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I guess that's forgot to say congratulations also to the grandparents, right? I think I saw Joe and Crystal, they probably outside, so congratulations to them. And I believe I heard Sean and Krista
their other son and daughter-in-law gave birth to not too long ago, maybe a week ago or something. The Barber family as well. Stephanie's helping with the baby and caring for them. So thank you for praying for them. All right. Well, you know, some people have the knack to reach people for Jesus Christ. You know, talking about Jesus and pointing the conversations toward the things of God, inviting people to church, or even having them consider, you know, people's spiritual life, letting them consider that, having them, the person consider their spiritual life, just seems like it comes easy for some people and just flows out of their life. Like just this past Sunday, after the second service was well over, a lady and her daughter came to ask if the little girl could go and use the restroom. So, you know, we said yes. They were playing up there at the park. And when they were done, she was leaving and she said, thank you. And I said, oh, no problem. And then Diane Bartosik was right next to me. She said the same thing. And all of a sudden, the conversation turned. Do you go to church? You know, we have services at 9 and 11. You should come. Well, my wife is the same way too. When we were church planning on Maui, she was my inviter. She was the inviter. She's still that way today. She does it sensitively, of course, but somehow she can find out about people's lives and many times have shared the gospel with complete strangers to this very day. And so she plants a lot of seeds. I spoke with one of our church members this past week, dear lady, who had landed up in the hospital. She's no longer there, but she was in the hospital. And of course, going through her suffering was not desirable, but she was, as she told me, she was overjoyed how great God is and amazing God is. Even though she was being cared for in the hospital, she ended up ministering to other people. She talked about the things of God, crossing bridges, inviting people to her home after she gets out and after this COVID thing passes, and told them about coming to MCC and telling them about Jesus. You know, even though she would rather have not have gone to the hospital, she said, you know what? God was working. God was working. She had the eyes and the ears to see. She had the love of Jesus in her heart that overwhelmed and overflowed to tell others about him and not be ashamed of her commitment to Jesus Christ, even though she was the one being cared for. One of our elders just shared with me last week that he was able to talk to a coworker who has been praying about talking about Christianity too. And he actively looks for ways to share Jesus at his workplace. You know, always being sensitive, but he's always on the lookout and aware of his witness for Jesus there. So many more of you, I know, share Jesus with others as well. But you know, not all Christians either are wired or gifted the same way. Sometimes it's a struggle for us to know how to cross the bridge from everyday conversation to then talking about the things of God, the spiritual things. We probably should admit also there are times that we just don't think outwardly and are perhaps afraid to speak, or, you know, we just don't know what to say. Sometimes it's as simple as just being willing to get to know someone, right? You meet someone out in the community, at work, or if it's a fellow parent on your child's sports team or whatever, and you just get to know them. And in that conversation, you can do what Diane and my wife does numerous times and say, hey, do you go to church? And if they say no, you might say, well, my family and I attend a church in Mililani Mauka, and see how the conversation goes from there. There are other times that you may be getting a little deeper in your conversation with someone and they say, you know, I'm certain I'm going to go to heaven even though I reject Jesus. Now, as a Bible-believing Christians, we know that's not true. That person has a lot to be concerned about. What do you say? Do you say, hey, brother, you know, if you reject Jesus, you're going straight to hell. Now, you could say that. You could say that, and you would be 100% correct, right? Or you could say, sir, if what you say is not true, or if what you think about Jesus and about heaven and hell and so forth is incorrect, would you want to know about it? And that might seem a bit more tender. It would give the other person the opportunity to either ask you for more or not, and you just go with the conversation with that. My friends, as we saw last time, all of us who are Christians, everybody here watching or outside or in here that profess to be Christians, we know that we are sent out by Jesus into this world to make disciples, and that involves sharing the gospel message, the good news of Jesus Christ, so that sinners would repent of their sins and trust Christ alone to rescue them. While we still have our breath, doesn't matter what age you are or how maybe physical things may have come into your life, it doesn't matter. As long as you have breath, we have a mission to fulfill, right? We are. If we actively go about it, we're going to run into all sorts of responses, right? Not everybody's going to be responding the same way. Well, today we're going to be reminded why John wrote his gospel. In the process, we'll also see Jesus ministering to a very pessimistic person, one that is known as Doubting Thomas. If you would, turn with me in your Bible, if you haven't, to John chapter 20. If you don't have a Bible, hopefully you have an outline and you can follow along there. John chapter 20. Verse 24. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the marks of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. In light of this text, there's our focus for this morning, and that is, MCC, we must have an evangelistic outlook so that we might see many come to trust Christ, saving faith in Jesus for their everlasting joy. Now, not only do believers in Christ sometimes think this way, but there are even skeptics and unbelievers who do the same. And maybe you can relate. Perhaps you've not entrusted your life to Jesus Christ yet because you think, or you're saying, "Prove yourself God, then I'll believe. Prove yourself God, then I'll believe." Notice with me verse 24 again. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." He said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." So here, John informs us that Thomas, one of the 12 disciples, was not there when the believers were gathered that Sunday evening, that first Sunday evening, when Jesus showed up in their presence. Apparently, he had a twin brother or sister. He's called Didymus, which means twin. Now, we don't know anything about that person. The scripture doesn't tell us about his twin. The other gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they only mention Thomas one time in their gospels, and that's along with the other disciples. It's only John who tells us more about Thomas. This is where we get our information about Thomas. You know, people know him as, and you probably heard it before, as Doubting Thomas, right? They say, "Don't be a Doubting Thomas." However, that may not be the best description of this man. He was more like the pitcher is half empty kind of guy, right? Little pessimistic, little gloomy, like Eeyore in Winnie the Pooh. But that's only one side of his character. Okay? You know, John first mentions him in John chapter 11. You remember that? That's the chapter where Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, his good friend. Remember, there Jesus got word that his dear friend who he loved, they said, was sick. Now, if you remember, the Bible says Jesus loved Mary, Martha, and their brother Lazarus. And the Bible says, therefore, he stayed where he was 2 more days. In other words, basically, the Bible says, because he loved them, he will let Lazarus die. And Jesus said, his friend's sickness would not ultimately be for the glory of God, because he would raise Lazarus from the dead. Well, after he let Lazarus die, and by the way, you can go back and online on our YouTube channel, you can go listen to the John chapter 11 chapter if you forgot about it. But after he let Lazarus die, because that was an act of love that he did, he tells his disciples, okay, let's go to Judea. Now, at that point, the disciples, their minds were blown. They're like, are you nuts, Jesus? They were just trying to stone you there, and now you're wanting to go back? That's crazy. Well, he tells them, Jesus then tells them, no, I have to do my work, and do my work in the day. Whereas the others do it secretly because they work to destroy me. You know, they will stumble, but I'm not going to stumble. Well, the disciples didn't want to go back. It would mean trouble. They didn't want to die. But Jesus assures them and says, I must go and I must wake up my friend, our friend who has fallen asleep. He says, I'm glad for your sake that I was here with you when Lazarus died, so that you may believe. So let's go. Well, you can just imagine them worried and afraid. If he goes back, they're going to kill him. Right? That's what they're thinking. And it's at this point that John introduces us to Thomas. And he says in verse 16 of John 11, tells us about Thomas, and this is what it says. So Thomas, called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. So yeah, Thomas was a little grim. Let's go so we can die with him, right? All right, Jesus is determined to go, can't change his mind. So guys, let's go and let's meet our own death too. So we see the pessimism, but we also see, I think, the courage and the devotion of this man. He saw trouble ahead. He saw it. And yet he said, let's go, guys. He was devoted to Jesus. Now, that's the kind of guy Thomas seems to be. Maybe devoted Thomas would be a better name than doubting Thomas. We could look at his great love for Jesus also in John chapter 14, but I'll leave that up to you. You can go read John 14 and learn a little bit more about Thomas there. But here, let's go back to the passage. We learned that he wasn't there at that first Easter Sunday evening when Jesus showed himself as the believers gathered together in that locked upper room, right? What Thomas was doing all that other time, I do not know. We can guess. Maybe he was so crushed, seeing the wounds of Jesus, right? Just it's on etched in his mind. Who knows? I don't know what he was doing. But we learn that the disciples told him continually, as the present tense indicates, that they continually told him that they seen the resurrected Christ. Thomas, he's alive. Thomas, we've seen him. Believe us, he's not dead. He has risen. And at that, Thomas says, unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe. He's a bit irreverent here, basically saying he's got to prove it. He's got to prove it. Show me God. Then I'll believe. Until then, I refuse and I will not. How do we respond to skeptics like that, or even believers who are struggling in their faith? Well, we need to do what Jesus does. Drive them and help them to understand. Number 2 on your outline, the good news is centered on Jesus Christ. Notice with me verse 26. 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Put your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." And Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." So the first Sunday Jesus appears to calm and reassure the disciples that have found their way back together, but Thomas was not there. You remember that? 8 days later, the Bible says, which for the Jews, the counting of days was inclusive, so it would have been the following Sunday. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. That's how the Jews would have reckoned counting here. But this time, Thomas was present with them, with the other disciples. Again, as in the previous Sunday, John notes that the doors were locked and Jesus appears once again. And he stood among the gathered disciples and he says what he said before, "Peace be with you." And then he immediately focuses attention on Thomas. Jesus knew what he was thinking. Jesus knew what he was wrestling with. What he demanded, right? "You said you would not believe if you didn't have proof until you're able to see, Thomas, and touch. Well, Thomas, I'm here. See for yourself. It's what you demanded. Reach out and touch me. Do not go on in unbelief, but go on believing. I've risen from the dead just as I've told you." My friends, Jesus is not only omniscient in that he knows all things. He knows our very thoughts and he knows what our hearts are heavy with, what we're wrestling with. He knows your heart. He knows what you're thinking about. But we also see that he's gracious and he's merciful to Thomas. Now, he does seem to offer a mild rebuke a little later. But here, he turns to Thomas, and he doesn't berate him. He doesn't say, "Hey, Thomas, what's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? You know all these other disciples. You were with them for 3 years with me. They're authentic. They're genuine. They're not going to lie to you, Thomas. Why didn't you believe what they said about me? Why didn't you believe the report that others were saying about me? That I've risen from the dead. Why are you so stubborn? Why are you so hard-headed?" Now, Jesus didn't have to accommodate Thomas's demand, right? But our Lord is gracious. He's compassionate and merciful. And in that moment, we see Thomas and his great declaration, "My Lord and my God." Now, a couple of things. First of all, now this is not like what we would hear somebody say today when there's kind of surprise and they say, "Oh God," right? That's not what's going on here. This reminds me of Psalm 23 where the psalmist says, "The Lord is my shepherd," right? No, this was a heartfelt declaration. Secondly, this is a declaration not simply that Jesus is a man, but that he is also God. This is a declaration of love. They already believed Jesus was more than a man, right? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. But now there is no doubt. There's no doubt. He is not just Lord and God, but he is my Lord, and he is my God. It's him I adore. It's him I love. He's my Lord. He's my God. He's my delight. He's my hope. Question is he yours? Is he yours? Now, some people believe that Thomas actually did reach out and touch the wounds of Christ. The scripture, however, doesn't say. It does say, however, if you look carefully at that passage, it does say, have you believed because you have seen me? Jesus said. Jesus says, seen, not touched. Well, I'm of the belief that he didn't touch Jesus. I can't prove that, Yet I'm of the opinion that he did not need to at that point. Sufficient it was to see the wounds of Christ and the very presence of Jesus right in front of his face. Thomas, Jesus gets Thomas to look to him, to center his eyes of faith, as it were, on him. Stop disbelieving, Thomas. Look here. Look here. My friends, that's what we need to do in a world that's filled with sinners just like us. As we aim to reach others and give them hope, we must point them to Jesus. For those who are genuinely seeking answers to the questions they have, we can give them answers, or we can point them to other believers who can answer those questions that they may be wrestling with. And God gives us reason to believe. There are answers to many of the questions that people can, that they have, that can satisfy them intellectually. But my friends, I don't think it's reasoned arguments that will ultimately win a sinner's heart to Jesus. I don't believe anything will take the place of the greatest expression and display of love for sinners by Jesus, with those nails in his hands that were driven there and in his feet, and a spear thrust through his side as he died on the cross in their place, in your place and mine. My friend, those wounds of Christ are your hope. It's your only hope to get right with God. Your only hope is to look to Jesus and receive him as who he is, Lord and God. I remember hearing a message from John MacArthur and reading a book of his. I can't remember the exact book. I think it was in a book too. But I remember hearing the message. This was decades ago, so I can't really pinpoint exactly what the message was. But I remember him sharing this. He said he encountered a guy who said, and went up to him and said, "Pastor MacArthur, every morning Jesus appears to me while I'm shaving." So Pastor MacArthur said, "Well, what do you do?" And the guy said, "Well, I continue to shave." To which John MacArthur said, "Well, then you didn't see Jesus. Because if you did, you would have fallen to your feet, fallen to your knees and worshiped him." Well, that's who Jesus is. He's Lord and he's God. And he does not refuse worship. You notice that here? He does not refuse worship. You know, in Acts chapter 10, you remember it talks about a man by the name of Cornelius, right? And he met Peter, one of Jesus' disciples. The Bible says when Peter entered Cornelius' house, Cornelius fell at Peter's feet and worshiped him. Now, what did Peter do in response to that? Huh? Did he say, "Wow, this is a little flattering"? No, he didn't. The Bible says he lifted the guy up and said, "Stand up, I too am a man." Now, Jesus didn't do that. He didn't do that. Thomas's declaration was fitting and appropriate and right for whom it was standing before him. Well, here, Jesus mildly rebukes Thomas, and he says, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those, happy are those who have not seen and yet believed." I thought, you know, before in my life, I thought in my Christian journey, and sometimes even in my struggles, I think, you know, "Jesus, if you were right here, like in the flesh, right with me, where I could see you, where I could touch you, you know, things would be better. I could trust you more." Well, as I thought about it, that kind of flies right in the face of what Jesus is telling Thomas here, right? Jesus says, "Happy are those who have not seen like you, Thomas, and yet they have believed." That's you and me. That's you and me today, right? Friends, many have seen Jesus. Remember that. Remember how many had seen Jesus. Many heard Jesus' audible voice as he stood right next to them. Right? Many saw him do amazing things, miraculous things, and yet they remained in their sins. We need to remember, my friends, what unites sinners like you and me to Jesus is faith. It's faith. When we believe on the Lord Jesus, we are saved and we are joined to Jesus Christ forever. Believing in Jesus is not just with the mind, where you accept facts, you know, about Jesus, about his work on the cross, about his burial, about his resurrection from the dead. No, believing in Jesus also involves relishing him. It involves adoring him. It involves cherishing him, savoring him, marveling at him in your heart, and turning from your sins, repenting, and surrendering your life to Jesus as your Lord and your God. No, believing in Jesus involves the whole being, your mind, your emotions, and your will. Jesus says, "Blessed are you and me who believe in Jesus Christ through the message of the gospel handed down through the ages, revealed in the Word of God." Yes, we don't have Jesus physically among us as the disciples did, but he says we may believe just like they did. Now, he's not saying that our faith is superior to theirs. That's not what he's saying. We are blessed because we experience his grace, his favor. We get forgiveness of our sins, right? We get to be adopted into his family. Most importantly, we get God. We get God. You know, this reminds me of 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8, where Peter says these words. He says in 1 Peter 1, 8, he says, "Though you have not seen him, you love him." We haven't seen him, but we love him. "Though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory." Finally, in light of this passage, don't lose sight of an evangelistic outlook. Don't lose sight of an evangelistic outlook. That's why we're doing the Halloween, stuffing the candies and putting tracts in there. I mean, we don't have any Harvest Fest for the last couple years. We didn't do anything last year. And RJ and Denise, you know, came up with this idea, and let's go and do this. They're going to come to us anyway. Let's do what we can to tell the gospel. Don't just give them what they want, but what they need, as RJ said. And giving you the opportunity as well to take some bags home and be God's light and pass out those things in your community and have that evangelistic outlook. Notice with me verse 30. "Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." Now John points out that Jesus did many other miracles. Miracles are like signs that point to something greater, right? He did many other miracles in the presence of the disciples that he did not include in this book. But he had specifically chosen what he decided to choose and included the gospel with the purpose. Here's this purpose, that the reader would believe that Jesus is the Christ. He's the Messiah. He's the anointed one. He's the promised rescuer that God promised to send way back in Genesis chapter 3, right? He is the unique Son of God, and that by believing, this is his purpose, that the reader would come to have life that only he can give. My friends, John himself wrote and included seven signs. You remember those seven signs, and plus an eighth sign of Jesus' resurrection to give us a picture of Jesus, who is the Word made flesh and dwelt among us. And John's purpose for writing what he does and putting the events about Jesus in the manner in which he does has an evangelistic purpose in mind. He wants the reader, he wants you and me to have faith alone in Jesus Christ. That's why he included things like Jesus turning water into wine at the wedding at Cana in John chapter 2, or Jesus healing the royal official's son in John chapter 4, or Jesus feeding the 5,000, and that included you add all the children and women, a lot more, right? In John chapter 6, he did that with five loaves of bread and two fish. That's why John included Jesus walking on the water to reach to the disciples where they were terrified on the sea because of the waves in John 6. Or Jesus healing the man born blind, which was a miracle that the people believed that only the Messiah would do when he came on the scene. Well, Jesus performed that messianic miracle by healing a man born blind, giving him sight in John chapter 9, and then raising of his dear friend Lazarus from the dead in John 11. And then the final sign of Jesus raising the dead 3 days from the dead, 3 days after he was crucified for our sins in John 20 and 21. And so MCC, as we approach our 41st anniversary, as we're so blessed to be planted here in this facility, can you imagine what, I can't imagine what we would do if we're still in a cafeteria where they don't allow churches to meet anymore. But we're so blessed to be here. But let's not lose sight of having that outward evangelistic outlook as we live and move in this world. Let's intentionally and thoughtfully point people to Jesus, as part of our mission statement says, to encourage all people to come to Jesus. Now, before I pray and close, I want to point out one last thing that I hope will be helpful to you and encouraging to you, and that is, don't give up on fellow Christians if they're struggling with doubt or anything else. Don't give up on them. And don't beat yourself up if you're one of them. All right? As Warren Wiersbe has said, how often we have refused to believe and have insisted that God prove himself to us. Just remember, friends, we all have a little bit of Thomas in us too. Okay? But remember this. Thomas, he loved Jesus. He was devoted to Jesus. And yet, obviously, he struggled. We see him struggling. Christians can be this way too. Maybe this describes you right now. Maybe you don't share, you haven't shared this with anyone, but perhaps you have some doubt, some gloomy picture about the promises that Jesus has, that has forgiven you of all your sins. Maybe someone you love has not forgiven you for the sins that you have committed against that person. And so you wonder if God ever will, or if he even did. Maybe someone in your life has let you down. And that can come in many, many different shapes, in various ways. And so you wonder at times, and you question at times, if God will keep his promise to you and never leave you nor forsake you. Maybe you've been praying about a particular subject in your life, and you've been praying for years, and nothing seems to be happening, at least according to your perspective. And you wonder, does God hear me? Will he answer? Has he just left me all alone to struggle with this burden on my heart? Maybe you have a believer friend who has genuinely received Christ, but has and is struggling with some questions now, maybe about the resurrection or other things that they might find in the Bible. Maybe you have a believer friend who has strayed away from Jesus. You know, during this pandemic time, we wonder, where are the believers that used to attend church? Not just our church, I'm just talking church general. All churches are experiencing that. And you wonder where they are. Are they doing okay? Have they broken fellowship? Have they lost fellowship with among other saints? Well, when people usually walk away from the Lord and they stop showing up at church, aside from pandemic kind of health reasons, it's usually because they're choosing to sin and live in sin. I used to tell the teenagers in my youth group all the time, the moment I don't see you in youth group, I know you're walking in sin. And sure enough, they're probably with a non-Christian girlfriend or boyfriend, and until the breakup happens, then I see them again, right? But usually that's what happens. And you know it, they know it. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. Don't give up on them or yourself. Friends, the believers somehow found Thomas, all right? They didn't give up on him. They were looking for Thomas. They were pointing Thomas to Jesus, right? They didn't give up on him when he struggled with what they were saying. Jesus is risen. He's alive. He's not dead. They kept telling him that, and he still refused. They didn't give up on him. Though they couldn't convince him, they did manage to get him back among the other believers in that room. And in the company and fellowship of the saints is where Thomas needed to be to experience the presence of Christ and the power of his word, the comfort of his word. So my friends, have eyes for the lost, yes. And let's reach those in our world and beyond for Jesus. But also have eyes for professing Christians that are struggling and perhaps have even drifted from the fellowship of the saints and their Savior. And maybe you know them because they used to come. Even during pandemic, they used to come, but now they're not showing up. Maybe you know them. Don't give up on them. Always go after them with the love of Christ and never give up on them. Keep pointing them to Jesus and the wounds on his hands and his feet and his side. See, I wouldn't want someone giving up on me. And I'm sure you wouldn't want someone giving up on you either. So let's not give up on them. Be his hands, be his feet. Go after them who are lost, but also after those believers who are struggling. Always encouraging them to believe on Jesus. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for allowing us the privilege to gather this morning. We thank you for your word, its encouragement. And we know that there is blessing, Lord, when we don't abandon the fellowship of the saints, but we gather together with people that love Jesus, that are different from us, have different strengths, different weaknesses, but have Jesus as our center. And there is blessing in that. And Lord, we experience it. And I pray that you would just continue to remind us of that, to share the gospel with people. Be outward looking. Don't be content in our own little huddle, but to have eyes to see that there are people, there are harvests that needs to be reached and reaped. And Lord, there are Christians that are struggling. Even now, especially during the pandemic, some are going through depression. Some are agitated. Some are having difficulties in their marriages, in their homes, with their children. We pray, Father, that you give us eyes to see, that we won't give up on them, but that we would go after them with the love of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Jason. Can I have everyone stand for our closing song?
Heart. Lord, we are calling out, lifting up your name for all to hear the sound. Like voices in the wilderness, we're crying out. As the day draws near, we'll sing until the whole world hears. Whoa.
Father God, you've given us the opportunity to be part of your family, as well as the responsibility and joy of sharing the gospel with others. We want to see our friends, family members, co-workers, and even enemies come to know Jesus personally. Only you can do that, so use us as your servants to make disciples in this world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you for being here. We'll see you next time.